His life is a legend. His death is an even bigger one. The only thing we know for sure is that he has existed. But nearly everything about him vanished in the mists of time. Welcome to a new episode of Kianuka's Fantasy Library. I'm Kianuka, and I want to take you onto a journey to the mysterious life of Klaus Störtebeker. It was around the year 1360 that young Klaus was brought into this world in the beautiful city of Wismar, in the north of Germany. It wasn't long before he left his hometown and moved to the Hanseatic city of Hamburg, where he enjoyed his vices, playing dice and drinking. And naturally, some nights of gambling and drinking resulted in a fight. One fight in particular must have been very heavy, for young Klaus was injured and the authorities got involved. Lucky for Klaus, he got free, and his opponents ended up being expelled from the city. But poor Klaus wasn't always as lucky as that. At some point of his gambling habit, he was out of luck, and soon out of money. Impoverished, he stood in front of the Hanseatic Gate of Hamburg and wondered how things should go on. Unable to find an answer, he wandered around town for a while, until he arrived at the port, and a thought occurred to him. He might not be of much use as a merchant, but perhaps he would find like-minded people among the pirates. But becoming a pirate wasn't as easy as he thought. The notorious pirate captain Goody Commissioners did not hire recruits lightly. Before he was able to become part of his crew, Klaus had to prove himself. And what better way to prove his worth than in a drinking duel? So both men put the beer jugs on, ready to drink as much as they can. But Goody Commissioners soon couldn't believe what he saw, when Klaus managed to empty his jug in one single go. You might now think, so what? Emptying a mug in one go? I can manage that too. Well, the jugs back then could hold up to 4 liters of beer or wine. So you might think twice trying this in one go. But Klaus didn't do this just once. He emptied jug after jug in one gulp, until Goody Commissioners had to admit his defeat. In the end, this duel did not just result in Klaus' membership of the crew, but also in his name, Störtebeker, which roughly translates to drop the mug. So his life as a pirate was about to begin. But Störtebeker's life took a turn when the Danish queen Margaret I occupied Stockholm in 1391. The people of Stockholm grew desperate. They were about to starve if they couldn't get goods from ships. The situation seemed hopeless. Until the Swedish king used his relative, Duke Albrecht II of Mecklenburg, to recruit partisans. Poor people who had fled from the countryside to the cities and other desperate souls gathered under the leadership of noblemen. In those people included Störtebeker and Goody Commissioners. The partisans, under the risk of their lives, managed to provide the Swedish population with food, so-called victuals. After a while, they were called Victualian Brothers, or Vitalian Brothers, alluding to those heroes who supplied the French army with food during the war against England in the 14th century. Following their successful operations against Queen Margaret I, Duke Albrecht II hired them again to damage Danish trade in the North and Baltic Seas. But the attacks on the ships of the Danes and the Lübeckers, who were on the Danish side, were soon followed by attacks on other Hanseatic ships. Those ships transported valuable goods, such as wax, salt, and potash. The pirates were particularly interested in the ships of the wealthy Hamburg merchants. But their primary concern was not to fight, but to gain loot. To do this, the Vitalian brothers had received letters of piracy, official letters that allowed them to rob other ships. This also allowed them to freely sell the stolen goods on the markets in Rostock and Wismar. And so, for a while, Störtebeker and his crew were not pirates, but buccaneers, licensed pirates under government protection. But at some point in history, the relatively secure life as a buccaneer had to come to an end. With the peace agreement of 1395, the Battalion brothers had lost their client. They settled on the island of Gotland and began raiding ships on their own account. As so-called liquor dealers, they distributed their loot fairly among themselves and gave away to the poor. Their new motto? God's friends and enemies to all of the world. But of course, all of this didn't go unnoticed. The Hanseatic League soon declared them to be a threat in their trades with England and the Netherlands. And so, they increased their efforts of persecution and combat against Störtebeker and Gudike Michels. Above all, the Hanseatic city of Hamburg. But despite all efforts, Störtebeker is said to have escaped the superior Hansekoppen again and again. But even though he escaped, Störtebeker failed the fight he was fighting against the Hanseatic League. He had to hide over and over again. After just 3 years, the Teutonic Order expelled the Battalion brothers from the refuge in Gotland. They left the Baltic Sea, but found new clients and also protection with the Frisian chiefs. In 1396, they gained support in Marienhafe, in the east of Frisia, where Störtebeker is said to have married the daughter of a Frisian chief. But at the same time, he is also said to have been given shelter in the Church of St. Mary. And until this day, the tower of the church is known as the Störtebeker Tower. But again, the diplomatic pressure from the Hanseatic cities grew too heavy, and so Störtebeker soon lost his base of operations there. But of course, he wasn't defeated yet. In the midst of August, in the year 1400, Duke Albrecht I of Bavaria, Count of Holland and Hanau, signed a new contract with the Battalion brothers. According to this, he placed more than 100 of the brothers under his protection. The contract also stated 8 captains' names, including a certain Störtebeker. Everything seemed to work out for Störtebeker. Too sneaky to be arrested by the Hanseatic ships, and protected by powerful allies. Everything was fine, or so it seemed. But fate can be cruel, and Störtebeker did not know what would come to him next. In late April of 1401, a traitor among Störtebeker's crew is said to have poured liquid lead into the rudder of Störtebeker's ship Tollerhund, and thus made it incapable of maneuvering. In the end, this was the straw that broke Störtebeker's neck. One of his own sabotaged him. Never would he have thought of that. Not in the Brotherhood of the Liquor Dealers. After a long bitter struggle, the Hanseatic fleet, under the leadership of Simon of Utrecht, captured him on his own ship and took him back to Hamburg on Utrecht's ship, the Bunte Kuh. Störtebeker was captured. According to legend, he is said to have offered a golden chain to the council in exchange for his life. A golden chain long enough to extend around the whole city of Hamburg. But the city council rejected and sentenced him to death. However, despite this rejection, they of course searched for the treasures of the liquor dealers, unsuccessfully in the end. But when the legendary gold treasure of the liquor dealers could not be found, the ship was sold to a ship's carpenter. And as he started to saw to dismantle the ship, he encountered something solid, hidden in the masts. Was the treasure. One filled with gold, the other filled with silver, and the third filled with copper. The carpenter, of course, took this as a blessing of the Lord, and had a crown made from the gold for the tower of St. Catherine's Church in Hamburg. But what happened to Störtebeker himself? Well, according to legend, Störtebeker was beheaded, together with 72 of his companions. The execution took place on the 21st of October in 1401, on the grass broke in front of Hamburg's harbor entrance, and was operated by the executioner Rosenfeld from Buxtehude. But before his beheading, Störtebeker was said to have the mayor make him a promise. The mayor of Hamburg, Kirsten Miles, is said to have promised to spare the life of all men Störtebeker would pass after he was beheaded. And so, Störtebeker went to his execution. He looked into the eyes of his companions, kneeled down, and awaited the axe. And when the executioner had done his duty, and the head fell off of Störtebeker's shoulders, his body arised, and the beheaded Störtebeker walked and walked. He walked past not less than 11 of his men before he was finally tripped. According to one legend, he was tripped by the executioner, who feared for his earnings, which he got per head. According to another legend, he was tripped by one of his own men, who feared that the mayor would break his promise if Störtebeker would go any further. But wherever the truth lies, in the end, the mayor didn't keep his promise, and all 73 pirates were beheaded that day. According to one version of the legend, it didn't end there. The executioner carried out all 73 beheadings himself, and without errors. But when a member of the council praised him for that, he is said to have replied that he enjoyed it so much that he could also execute the entire assembled council. And of course, he was then taken into custody and beheaded by the youngest councillor himself. However, the heads of the pirates were impaled all along the River Elbe, and all possible legacies of Störtebeker, such as his drinking cup, were ultimately destroyed in the Great Hamburg Fire of 1842. And that's where his legend ends. Until this day, the life of Störtebeker is a legend, and also a mystery. Something like that could have happened, but we will never know for sure. We don't know if he really was a merchant, or when and where he was born. But what we do know is that Störtebeker and Captain Gödicke Michels actually existed. Proof of their existence can be found in British chronicles that document pirate attacks on English merchant ships. Their names appear again and again from 1394 to 1399. Experts, however, consider Michels to be the actual leader of the Vitalian brothers. What we know about these seafarers is that they entered a blockade of Stockholm by Danish troops at the end of the 14th century, and later attacked ships in the North and Baltic seas. But what is left of Störtebeker's legacy? Well, nowadays, ships, streets, beers, sport clubs, festivals, and songs are named after Störtebeker, the oldest of which was created around a year after his death. And even today, the pirate Störtebeker is glorified as a Robin Hood of the poor. The legend persists that the Vitalian brothers supported the poor and needy with part of his loot, and the people remember him in different festivals. The best known Störtebeker festival is probably the one in Ralsvik, which tells possible adventures of his life, and of course, one highlight every few years is the scene about his death. And in Hamburg, you can still find a statue reading Gottes Freund und aller Welt Feind. God's friend and enemy to all of the world. Hey, you're still here! Thank you very much for watching this video till the end. If you like this video, please support me and click the subscribe button to get notified when new videos come out. And if you want to know more about the topics I'm talking about, please take a look at my website and visit me on social media. See you next time! Bye!